All right. Well, thank you, everyone. Thank you for tuning in around the world. Again, I really appreciate the opportunity to speak today about the Women's Canadian Program. And today I'm hoping to share some learnings through World Cups and Olympics, success, but mostly failure, because that's how we learn. And I thought I would start with a little bit about myself. You know, I grew up in Switzerland, completely mad about football, love scoring a goal, love a good dive, as you can see. You know, didn't quite make it to the professional level, so that semi-pro level. But what really rise from that period of my life is, you know, that passion for the game, day in, day out. And I think I still carry this today, working with players, working with staff, and for those who work in the game, you know how much energy it takes and passion. So I think it's really part of my DNA. And also, you know, I would like to think that I didn't make it for physical reason, but if you talk to my coach, they might say that it was mostly for technical reason. But it's still to this day, I still try to answer question that, you know, I was asking myself years ago. So from there, I went to the University of Lausanne, where I completed a degree in physical education and history. My third year, I went to UBC, which sort of opened my eyes in Canada about, you know, what was able to be done, what different curriculum there was around the world. And when I came back, I did my research in youth biometrics. And then I decided to head out for a master in biomechanics at Eddie Kwan University in Australia. Really thought, you know, Australia is top line in terms of research integration. And I love also a good surf. So I was like, why not, you know, match the two of them. Over there, I was working with John Cronin, who was a Kiwi. And he asked me, you know, do you want to come to New Zealand to do your PhD? And that was a huge opportunity for me to go to AUT University, go back to the research in long-term athlete development, doing my PhD in that area, an area that was growing at the time in the late 2000s. And at the same time, John was really good at setting up his student working in the industry of high performance sports. So for me, obviously, football was my passion. And he hooked me up with New Zealand football. And that's where I met John Herdman, working in New Zealand football. And the first thing we did was working towards a national player development framework. So they had already launched what they called the Whole of Football Plan, which I believe is still running to this day. But my role in that was to bring at the forefront the research that was being done in sort of athletes and player development. And that was a big opportunity, as well as working in coaching development. At the same time, I had a massive opportunity to work with the Football Ferns, the women's national team, as John Herdman was also the coach, as well as the technical director for New Zealand football. And going to the World Cup with the Football Ferns in 2011, I really realized how real this was and how much the women's game was growing. For me, you know, I was, at that time, I had not been exposed a lot to women's football. And I realized how much of an amazing experience and amazing opportunity that was again. And I think the biggest thing I learned from being in Australia and New Zealand was that integration of sports science in high performance environment, but also working with tight staff member, because we didn't have a lot of budget and we only had 7 staff member. So working collaboratively as a staff, as a tight group, is really something that I carried on. After that World Cup, John Herdman got the job in Canada. And so he was getting a team ready to qualify for the London Olympics. And he asked me if I wanted to join him. You know, the program, Canada had finished last in the previous World Cup. It was due to a rebuild. There was one staff member left. There was no player data history. There was no legacy plan at the time. And so that was a big opportunity. And one of the first things John did, and he's really good at that, and is sharing his vision for the program. And there was 3 goals, and to this day we still follow these goals. And I'm sure that in every, you know, program in you know, national team program, it's all about sustaining success, which is our number one goal, but also producing more Sinclair more often. So working the pipelines, creating players by design and not by chance, and then strengthening the base. And so that vision, you know, he shared it with us, with the players, with the board, obviously. And then we qualified for the Olympics. And then we went on to the Olympics and we got a bronze medal out of this, you know, going from being last at the previous World Cup to, you know, sort of 13 months later, winning a bronze medal. And the biggest thing there was that I went back to, so I hadn't finished my PhD when I left New Zealand. So I was going back to New Zealand for, you know, 6 months to finish it off before I was going to come back to work with the Canadian team. And the biggest thing, I'd been asked to write a little blurb about my Olympic experience for the university. And the biggest thing, I looked back and I looked for it. And the biggest thing was a shared vision and that connection between the staff and the player. And it was very simple. It was about seeing the flag rise. And I think, you know, losing to the US in the semifinal, regrouping around that was a big thing, regrouping around that vision of working together. And so it was a huge success for the team, for the program, but also for the Canadian public. And from there, well, I got hired by the Canadian Sports Institute when I finished my PhD in early 2013 and continued working with the team and being part in what we call the quadrennial plan, because the women's team, in essence, is an Olympic team. Obviously, they competing in the World Cup, and this was a huge cycle for us with the Canadian World Cup, but also getting ready for Rio. And so working on those three goals that I mentioned, you know, sustained success was all about the women's national team. So here you can see on the right, the sort of the different pathways. But one big advantage that we were trying to leverage was the start of the NWSL, you know, and having all our players in the NWSL. So we had one calendar, one continent, which allowed us from November to sort of March to really work as a national team program, centralized program. But also another big, big project that we had was our acceleration program. So how can we, you know, accelerate our young players that are doing really well in the NCAA, but also our women's national team player? How can we push them forward and give them better services for them to become a top ranked women's national team player? And underneath, we had our, obviously our youth team and then our XL regional, which was, you know, in each of the province in Canada, because it's such a big country, it becomes challenging, but each province had a center, and then we had super center, or we have super center where it's best with best. And for me, in my role, the biggest thing was about aligning those system and processes from a sports science standpoint. So now I wasn't only working with the youth national team, but I was also working across the youth system and making sure that that goal too was taken care of in terms of producing players by design. I had to get creative, you know, working with the CSI, servicing obviously Canada Soccer, working with our main funding partner on the podium, thinking about the performance of the players and the team, and, you know, working with a very tight budget. Had to get creative, working with universities, setting up matching scholarship between, you know, a university giving a certain amount of money, matching that with the Sports Institute or Canada Soccer, and doing some of that slow work of research. At the same time, the student were also embedded inside our system, working with the youth team or working with the recs. So the first thing we did, you know, brought a student from New Zealand. Only a year after finishing my PhD, I got Josh Truin to come over and work with us and really investigating some of the factors that were affecting match running performance and how we could use that data that we had sort of collected over the last 4 or 5 years to inform our, you know, our approach better. Also look at heat acclimatization with the master's student, you know, getting ready for the Rio Olympics, but also in Canada in 2015, really hot, can be really hot weather. as well as, you know, preparing for Tokyo, which is going to be a really hot Olympics. We all know that. And then looking at how we were loading our youth players as well, you know, with Bob, and how we could monitor that and change some of our loading parameters to make sure that we were doing best practice with our youth players. And then obviously we have our testing battery, but how can we refine that to make sure that we're testing the right thing and making the best out of the data we were collected? So integrating these, you know, these students, you know, and I'll be honest, because it's you know, fair labor, they were getting this experience of working in industry, but also doing their research. And that was supporting the whole plan from top to bottom. Well, in 2015, it didn't go how we wanted to, you know. You can have the best plan, but sometimes it doesn't work out. And it was obviously a huge disappointment not to be performing on home soil, but we had to look in, and, you know, staff were disappointed. I was disappointed. And then the players as well, obviously, hugely disappointed to let the nation down, the jersey down. And when you speak to them also, you know, letting the staff down. And I think that's one of the biggest learning from that period, is that level of honesty between the staff and players to look in, and, you know, we had each other's back, sort of thing. So, you know, had to learn from failure. So obviously players that you put on the field are the biggest difference. So there was a change in guard in terms of the number of players that first of all, we had to go from a 23 player roster to a 18 player roster, because that's the Olympic squad. But also we had to trust the system and bring some new players in, trust the rookies, you know, young players like Deanne Rose here on this picture, 16 years old, needed some new abilities. You know, she was bringing pace. Nichelle Prince, she was bringing tremendous pace. Jean Becky, tremendous pace. You know, things that we were missing at the World Cup to create chances to score goals. But, you know, we're all sitting here and we're all part of a backroom staff. So we also had to think about, well, how do we operate as a staff? And we built on continuity from those last sort of 5 years of working together, but also John was really good at bringing some additional staff that was going to make a difference. So Kenneth Heinemüller as an assistant coach from Denmark, Jason DeVos, you know, diehard Canadian, to come also as an assistant coach. And then we had to look at our system and processes. So reflection process, how do we improve from camp to camp to camp to bring that team to the level that was needed to get to step on the podium again? So we used the De Bono's hat as an example. You know, what do we keep? What do we change? How can we innovate? What can we do differently to get better? And then as a staff, we did also an exercise around, you know, what's our superpower? You know, what do we bring to the staff, to the team that's different? And, you know, like, for example, the Hulk, well, I'm not as jacked as the Hulk, but, you know, I like to think I bring positive energy, good energy, you know. And we also worked about, what is your kryptonite? That high level honesty of what puts you over the edge, what doesn't allow you to work well in the environment. For me, eat, sleep, move are my three biggest thing. You know, if I don't get good sleep, good exercise, and eat well, well, if these things are disrupted, it's not good for me. I mean, it's not good for most people, but it really affects my mood and energy and my ability to deliver it for the players. And so we went to the Rio Olympics and we won another medal, working from a failure, learning from failure. And I mean, it's pretty standard that you learn well from failure. If you don't, you know, you're not asking yourself the right question. So I thought, you know, in this period of time, we all can do with a little bit of football. And this is just a highlight of, during that quadrennial, the journey of that team across the 4 years.
smile. What it takes to fool this town. I'll do it till the sun goes down and all through the night time. Tell you what you want to hear. Keep my sunglasses on while I shed a tear. It's now the right time. Yeah, yeah. I put my arm around so you are strong. Only alone I will cry out now. You'll never see what's hiding out deep down. Yeah, I know I've heard that they let you feel in the only way to make friendship true. And you will break it now. Yeah, yeah, yeah. I put my arm around so you are strong.
Yeah, pretty isn't perfect, but they told me I was worthless. Had to dig deeper when my kids hit the surface. Way more than physical, this is soul searching. The pain from the pressure to perform equals purpose. No sympathy, nervous energy. Second place, one said they don't remember me. I'm not stopping till the end. Got the sun on my face and my back is to the wind.
Yeah.
What don't kill you only makes you strong. Yeah. The road to glory takes a little longer.
Yeah.
What don't kill you only makes you strong. Yeah. I got the will to go a little longer. I got the will to go a little longer. Woo!
Tamires. Rose just inside her evades. And Rose could be in behind. She's on side. Sinclair. Christine Sinclair. It's two.
Okay, I hope this video came through well for everybody. And so build on that success of, you know, going back-to-back medals, the most important thing for us was to continue to work on that same framework of the three goals, you know, that sustained success, building the pipeline, broadening and strengthening the base. But as you know, the women's game is changing really fast. I mean, even 3-4 years ago, it's not the same as it's now, you know. And so one of the biggest thing was, well, how can we get more players in more professional environments, better professional environments, because that's how players progress in the daily training environment. But that meant, you know, once you take them out of the NWSL or they go away and you encourage them to go and experience, you know, other environment, well, you can't get together as much, right? So you got to be more clinical when you get together. We also encourage young players, you know, bypass the NCAA because it's the best environment being a professional club, you know, being with the best every day. That's how you're going to become a world-class player. So those were some of the key shifts that we were having. Another one is, you know, On the Podium, our main funding partner, was encouraging next gen, you know, young players, progressing the youth, right? And at the same time, the CSI was developing a different structure where young practitioners, you know, for example, some of those students I was using that were working with us, well, now we were able to have sort of like a mentorship program where they would get a sort of entry-level practitioner to then work with the team, work with the youth, gain experience, and grow through the Canadian system as a practitioner. So we hired Chloe Verley as a key staff to work full-time with our youth system. And from a physical standpoint, well, you know, I talked about these different environments. So being clinical and individual periodization, that key hire staff and gold medal project. So who are we? Who are our best player? Who do we focus on and put our resources towards? The remote monitoring. We had to get smart how we could monitor players in their club environment, wellness, heart rate, RPEs, you know, and from a getting together, being able to train harder and smarter. So how do we get players to, you know, don't feel the travel as much? Load forecasting. We have now almost a decade of GPS data getting ready for tournaments and games. How can we use this to peak and prepare for FIFA windows? Our testing, not as much time with the players. How can we get testing, on-field testing? You know, our heat management, heat stress. How do we get this on-field too? So being a lot more practical and sort of that invisible monitoring, if you like. And then finally, our supplement periodization, which was critical as well to peak for the events. In terms of match data, you know, or data in general, continuing to work with universities, with OTP to have innovation for gold grants, you know, finding those opportunities to get more people involved with that expertise that you need to keep moving forward. How can we centralize our data, present our data better? And this was all about individual impact, team performance, and the system integration in the sports science and strength and conditioning. Well, in 2018, there was a big change in the leadership. You know, John Herdman started working for the men's program, head coach of the men's program. But the great thing was Kenneth, assistant coach at the time, became the head coach. So he brought a great, you know, a great different leadership to the team, which was very valuable, refreshing. But at the same time, he knew our system and processes. He knew how to work in continuity. He knew what was making our team successful. And that was another opportunity, working with the men's program now to pool resources, to have a greater synergy across the organization, which was a new thing for Canada Soccer. I know some FAs obviously are doing that. Before us, that was a new thing. Well, what did that mean from the physical performance department? Well, now I was able to lead across the men's and the women's program. At the top there, you know, our sports dietitian was not only working with the women's program, but now more resources to work across, better expertise, greater exposure to football. Same with our data scientists, you know, more data. How do we pull out data? How do we work better in having centralized data system? And then underneath our, you know, youth teams and, you know, Chloe on the women's side and Yannick on the men's side, interacting, getting exposed to different environment, mentoring, leading. So the growth of the staff is ever present in the staffing structure and something that we value greatly. Well, this is a picture of the Parc des Princes. And going into the 2019 World Cup, we had a very talented team. Some people might say it was the most, you know, best team Canada ever seen on the field. We were young, we were fresh, but that wasn't enough. You know, we got knocked out of the competition in the round of 16. And again, some massive learning and a lot of questions, you know, for myself and for the rest of the staff and the players. And I personally, if I was to share something, it was my third World Cup, and I felt like I had this nailed down. I was pretty confident that we would do really well at this World Cup and we would go really far, knowing the players, knowing the staff, but we failed. And we had to go back to the drawing board. And I always come back to this, to those moments, to that passion. And I live for those moments. And I know most of you live for those moments. Where to think about our vision, our purpose for existence. How do we reframe a little bit our plan and our purpose to bring this team to the next level again and have the discipline to sort of bring it together and stick to what we do best. And again, one of the biggest messages for me is if you want long-term growth, you got to trust the character that you have in your backroom staff and the competences. You're always going to improve your competences if you have a growth mindset, and you got to have the right people in there. And I thought to finish off, I've leave you with something. This is something for me that gets me up in the morning every day. I know in here, you know, listening, not everybody is working towards the Olympics, but I know that you all have a goal, something that drives you, and I thought I'd leave you with that. I would like to thank all the players I've worked with over the years, you know, all the staff that are named down here and all the organization that I've worked with and support our program. Thanks.